Hello and welcome everybody to this podcast series. We are here at the DSM-Firmenich Aqua Days in Vienna. My name is Moritz Müller. I'm the managing director of the fish side. Our guest today here is Rizky Darmawan. He's joining us from Indonesia. Hi, Rizky.
Good to meet you. Hi, Moritz. Nice to meet you. Nice to be here. Thank you for having me in your podcast tonight.
Yeah. Oh, it's our pleasure.
Yep.
Rizky, tell us who you are.
Hey. Well, my name is Rizky Darmawan. I'm first and foremost, I'm a shrimp farmer from Indonesia. Our company is called Delta Marine Indonesia, and we've been, like, our family has been in this business for like over 40 years, but and our farm has been running from 2008, basically.
Yep. All right. How did you get into shrimp farming?
Well, as I said before, we are and always been this like shrimp farming family. Like my dad has been in this business for over 40 years. He's been trading shrimps for almost his lifetime. And I guess like the short answer is that I'm born into it. But the longer answer is that when I went to the States, I had to decide what to study. But before I went there, I actually made a decision to myself to come back to Indonesia to build business with my family. And then when I was there, finally, I realized that why don't I just learn something that is relevant to the family business. So I ended up taking a fishery science major, learning all I can about this industry, and then coming back and apply it to our family business.
Yeah, that's great. Where in the States did you study?
Oh, I was in Seattle. I was in a University of Washington in Seattle. I studied, it's called the School of Aquatic and Fishery Science.
Okay.
Yes.
Very different climate in Indonesia, I think.
Oh, very different.
Yeah.
I mean, when I was there, I was mostly learning about oysters and salmon.
Okay.
But at
okay.
least I got through the basics. I know the physiology. I know, how shrimp lives, and then what are water parameters. So it actually helps, a bit, I would say. At least I didn't start from zero when I came back.
Mm-hmm. Rizky, your farm, obviously you're here today because your business, your farm, it's an outlier, right?
I like to think so.
Yeah. many farmers struggle and curse with some things like algae that you are actively working with in your ponds, and they try to fight the microbiology rather than work with it. Mm-hmm. How is your farm different?
I guess one thing that is a bit different than what other farms are doing is that since I have a background knowledge about all of this about aquaculture, then I can start to apply it in getting more data out of it and then learning from what we did right and what we did wrong. So we analyze all of our data and then hopefully from that we don't make the same mistake as the one we did before, on the previous cycles. So I think that's one thing that we really have a good thing going on in our farm. And with, you said, plankton or microbiology. So in the years that we have been doing that, we realized that one of the things that you mentioned, plankton, is very unstable. So we actually have to find a way to make the system more stable, because with stability, you will have less stress for the shrimp. And again, that's what everybody wants, to help the shrimp grow healthy and happy. So we try to develop a more of a heterotrophic approach in our farming business. And I guess I can say that we've been having an amount of success in doing that. It also shows in our harvest results, and hopefully in our profit too.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Just for our listeners to give a bit of context, you farm in 70 ponds, correct?
Yeah, our farm has, in that one site, we have around 70 ponds.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's the stocking density normally?
Normally we do 150, 180 per square meter, mm-hmm. But we are trying to increase that, especially in our experimental ponds. Mm-hmm. We have round tanks, we have raceway ponds that we do experimental on. This next cycle we will stock around 220 or 250 in those ponds just to test if we can make it work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exciting.
It's very exciting.
Yeah. Okay. So you're basically saying the approach is very scientific.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously that brings a lot of data necessary, data control necessary, right? You need a lot of data points. You can track your progress or your non-progress.
Yes.
So how does that look on the farm? Like, are you specced out with sensors everywhere? Do you do everything by hand?
I mean, we have our own team of like lab technicians that take samples, take water parameter samples like every day or twice a day, actually. Mm-hmm. With that, we have a robust data that we can analyze with, so that like we can look back and see what treatment we did and then what happens like 1 or 2 days after that.
Okay.
And see if it works or not.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And like recently we had a really good cycle, and with that we also can see what works and what's not. It really shows like in that set of data, you can really see the difference between them.
Very good. Congratulations on your great cycle.
Thank you so
great
much.
Great to hear. No, I mean, many farmers have struggled, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we write the news, we look at it, we're like, oh my God, shrimp is over now.
You know? It was like people were saying, like, people are struggling and you hit a record. And I was like, we got lucky.
Were you allowed to tell anybody about it?
I mean, yeah, to a certain point, of course.
Yeah. Were you scared? You know, everybody's like cursing the industry, what's going on, the conditions, and you're like, actually, guys.
Yeah, guys, I mean, like, we've been doing well. We made good decisions, I guess. Mm-hmm. And I think, like, again, like, it's nothing really fancy or nothing, like, difficult. Everybody can do that. You just have to apply, like, more scientific method in your farming. And I think, like, everybody can succeed with that.
Right. This is a good point, right? Mm-hmm. Because Vibrio,
yep,
it's a menace for many shrimp farmers. It's very difficult to handle.
Mm-hmm.
How are you handling Vibrio outbreaks in your ponds?
Okay. Yeah. Well, first things first, before you have Vibrio outbreaks, you have to actually prevent that. And you do that by actually stocking good bacteria to outcompete those Vibrios. And as you know, the Vibrio is a very opportunistic bacteria. They can grow almost everywhere. So again, like a lot of farmers are just like using like one kind of probiotics or like one kind of strains, and it doesn't work because like if you only use bacillus might be good in the water body, but might not be good in the in the bottom pond. So you actually have to use another type of bacteria. So again, like you have to fill all of those niches where Vibrio can grow and compete with them in those places. You cannot just like focus using one strain, and that won't work.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, like if one good bacteria doesn't work, then the other ones will actually help them in that niche and hopefully suppress the Vibrio even further.
Right.
Yep.
So the basis of this is an understanding of the ecosystem and the interaction between your water column and your soil under it, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
Not even the soil. I'm like, it doesn't have to be the soil. I mean, most of our ponds are using concrete and HDPE liner.
Mm-hmm.
And even with that, Vibrio can grow because they can create a biofilm on on the surface, like bottom surface. And in those parts, sometimes it's neglected because people think like, okay, you use bacillus, and then if you do a TBC or TVC test, it shows that you have a really big amount of like good bacteria, and that's okay. But like usually it's not, because you're not testing on that part of your ecosystem yet. So it might not. It might be a time bomb that it will just blow up anytime when another factor goes in and just mess with the system.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So another question around the pond approach, right? Farmers tend to have strong opinions when it comes to farming the ponds autotroph or heterotroph.
Yes.
What is yours?
I mean, I'm all into like more into a bacteria dominated system, because again, it's just a lot more stable. Like if you do an autotroph system, like you will have like pH variation throughout the day, like day and night, and then you have DO variety day and night, because like again, like with planktons, they will produce oxygen when sunlight is there, but at night they will actually consume them, and those factors will create like an ecosystem for a shrimp that is unstable. Because again, like if you know about pH, it's a log scale. So like 5 or 0.5 or 1 point of change means that it's 10 times away from the normal,
right?
Like, or from the morning and the night. So it really stresses the shrimp.
Right, it's a stressful environment.
Oh, yeah. It's very stressful. And again, plankton, there's just a lot of factors that you cannot control, like the weather. If it's cloudy or if it's raining, then plankton won't have any sunlight. And then they will just crash. Mm-hmm. That there is something that is outside of control. And like, why would you want that? You, as a farmer, as a good farmer, you want to be able to control everything.
Okay.
And that's why, in my opinion, a heterotroph system is better, like especially in the outdoor setting, mm-hmm. outdoor pond settings.
Okay, so it's a more versatile approach really to the microbiology you've got going.
Yes, mm-hmm. exactly.
Okay, interesting. Mm-hmm. Now, for a farmer who's pursuing bioflock, what recommendations would you make for farming practice in ponds? And are there any factors that actively support this, like pond shape? Is there something?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. So we've been testing a new pond design in our farm. It's basically a raceway pond where water just continually flows around like a river. It doesn't stop. And we've been having really good cycles. I mean, we already had it in four cycles, and basically we have always been succeeding in those cycles. Mm-hmm. What we see, actually, we didn't expect this, but we kind of just like build it and see what happens for that pond. Because I've been having this design in my head for like when I was graduated, and then finally I had the green light to build that.
Okay. Yeah. A year-long vision comes to life.
Well, again, like the big boss had to sign it for me to be able to build
that. So your father?
Yes, it is. But with that, so my father just said, okay, like, let's see what happens. Mm-hmm. Then we built one. And again, like, a lot of things that we didn't expect that to happen, it actually happens. Like, one of the things is that in normal ponds, you want to be able to settle your sludge into the, like, repository or, like, your stream toilet where you can flush it out. Mm-hmm. Well, in this system, basically, it's very hard for any of the, like, most of the waste to settle. So in the end, they will just be kept like moving around the water, floating. But what we see is that it creates like a very good substrate for the bacteria to grow in. And in the end, it was so easy to make a bioflock system in that particular pond. And also with that, we found out that it creates a natural shading where plankton couldn't grow as good as in the other ponds.
Right.
So it's like, it's a side effect, but it's a good, and it's a like it has a double good side effects.
Okay.
In that, and I'm actually excited in this particular design because you can really build it like a housing system where you just put walls over walls over walls, and it's really efficient in land use, mm-hmm. where you cannot see that in round tanks where you actually lose a lot of the land. Especially in the corners, if you compare that to the conventional ponds, like the square ponds.
Right. Yeah, because it's very inefficient putting them next to each other.
Yeah. Well, with the raceway, it's basically just building a house mm-hmm. for the shrimps.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Bioflock needs shrimp houses.
Yeah.
I like it. Very good. You talked about waste. Mm-hmm. Obviously, phosphate connected to waste.
Yes.
Is a problem. How does it express itself, that problem, and what can farmers do against it?
Oh, I mean, like. Again, like looking at the data that we had in this previous cycle, we saw that every time phosphate goes up, we see like a lot of the bad planktons also grow, like the dinoflagellates. Mm-hmm. Again, if you see our graphs, you will see like if the phosphate goes up, you can see the dino starts to come out. So again, like you don't want those the dinos to be present, or at least you want it as minimum as possible, because it's one of those planktons that it's easily dangerous for the shrimps, especially if they dominate your system. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And again, like, and one way to actually do that is in like right now, what we can do right now is by doing more of the water exchange.
Okay.
Yeah, because again, like in Indonesia, we are blessed with a good source of water source. Yeah, again, we're an archipelagic country. We have access to the sea. Mm-hmm. We have long coastline. We can get like fresh water from there, and it's really important, because what we saw also in our case is that the one that does like less water exchange actually didn't go that far as the one that that does that, the like a bit more of the water exchange.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Now, connected to this, going on to what a farmer can do, what many do these days, is work with probiotics, right?
Yes.
I mean, it's already great to see that there is a certain step towards working with microbiology industry. However, probiotics do have certain challenges. For instance, the quality control, right? Mm-hmm. You don't know if your probiotic substance is actually an active ingredient, right?
Yes.
Or is the active ingredient dead?
Mm-hmm.
So how do you know your bacteria is working as
okay.
a farmer?
Well, again, like, first things first, you have to have like a very reliable like source of your probiotic or producer of the probiotics. Because if you don't have that, again, like you never know what kind of bacteria you have in that product. It might be like, sometimes it might have like a dangerous amount of Vibrio and you don't want that. Mm-hmm. You don't want to actually put more Vibrio into your system. And one thing that we realize is that it's better to have those products that is in the powder form instead of the liquid form, because in liquid form a lot of things can happen. It might be contaminated again, like a Vibrio might grow there. Well, if it's in the powder form, it's deactivated, so you have a better chance to have a more pure product with that. And I guess one thing that you can see if the bacteria is working is actually by the foam. If you see like your pond or pond surface has a lot of foams, that means like the bacteria is producing the required enzyme to break down all of the excess nutrients in your pond. Mm-hmm. And it's a very good sign. Mm-hmm. One of the cases in our site is that whenever like the foam goes out, usually like disease will come in. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of the excess nutrients will not be broken down and then will be used by like more dangerous bacteria or planktons. And then yeah, like you get cases with like wet feces disease or even AHPND when that happens. Mm-hmm. So we try to keep it, we try to have like a healthy amount of bacteria or you can say a healthy amount of enzymatic process inside the pond. Mm-hmm. To make sure that it's healthy.
Okay, so basically keep the microbiology alive.
Mm-hmm.
To make sure that you don't get the microbiology you don't want.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Very good. Is there any way that farmers can approach the challenge of feeding? It plays a large role in pond chemistry because you're launching a nutrients, basically, mm-hmm. right? How do you approach feeding in high versus low density systems?
Okay, well, actually, coming back to what you said, it plays the biggest role in like your pond system, at least in your water chemistry, because mm-hmm. you're basically putting nitrogen, phosphorus, carbon into the system, and you have to be able to balance that out. Because again, like if that builds up, you will have an overloaded system in your pond where it can collapse like whenever.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And to balance that, I think you have to have a healthy amount of cleaner water. So, and coming back to the feeding part, low density versus high density, I think it's more about knowing your carrying capacity, and that carrying capacity is affected by how good your bacteria is and how much water exchange can you do.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So like let's say like doesn't matter the density, maybe like your system can only support 100 kilo of feed per day. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter your density. I mean, like if it's a higher density, then that'll be like a smaller shrimp, and then you have to do something like maybe a partial harvest or at least increase your carrying capacity. That is part. But again, like in the smaller density, you will hit that level like longer way, like further away. While in a higher density, you will hit like maybe 100 kilo per day on DOC, maybe like 40 or 50. Then you start to like you have to make a different treatment to prolong that cycle or prolong that current capacity.
Okay. This is all very, very interesting. I have mm-hmm. I have a few questions I would still want to get through to you. We only have a few minutes left, so okay. If you keep it a little bit shorter on these. I'd like to know, what are your biggest achievements or most exciting projects going on right now? Pick either or talk about both.
Okay. I mean, like, at least one thing that excites me like right now is that coming back to the raceway ponds, right now we're trying to build raceway ponds that has, so we're thinking about sustainability in this case. We want to put solar panels on top of those raceway ponds. Mm-hmm. That way, like, it's very efficient because you basically use the same land to produce shrimp and then produce energy. That's one of the things. And again, another side effect is that you're blocking sunlight. So you're also blocking plankton growth. Hopefully, and again, like, this is also experimental. Hopefully it works. And if this works, then we will basically moving forward, we'll build this kind of ponds. I think that'll be very interesting, like, in terms of sustainability, because we were trying to make, like, this industry greener.
Yeah. Yeah. Exciting. So how do you see this industry developing over the next decade?
I mean, I bet there's going to be like huge leap or like advance in this industry, because again, this like aquaculture is a fairly young industry compared to like poultry or cattle. And again, like if you see those industry, it's like it's already so easy to grow them. Maybe like investment wise or return wise, it's not going to be that great. Well, in this industry, since there's a lot of knowledge gap in this business, like people still see this in high risk, but with high risk, it also comes with high return. So it is still interesting, and there's a lot of gap that needs to be filled by like young minds who's trying to, I don't know, make this world a better place or try to research something that actually can make a difference in terms of food production.
Okay. So your advice for young peers, young talent would be entrepreneur in shrimp farming?
Yeah, of course. I mean, again, like I say this like a lot of times, especially with my friends, that like this business does might not look sexy, but like the profit's still sexy. You don't have to wear a suit like everywhere or go to the office. What matters is like the profit, and as long as you can make profit, I think like a lot of people will be interested to come into this business. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Again, like we're not trying to grow big shrimps. We're trying to make big profit. Mm. It's business in the end.
Okay, very good. So you're holding a presentation here these days to all the attendees at the DSM-Firmenich Aqua Days.
Yes.
What is the key takeaway from your presentation?
I think one of the DSM-Firmenich friend told me, Ben, they asked me to come here to be a speaker to tell them about more of like a farmer's perspective on how to manage your farm. And again, I think it's quite rare to have a perspective from the farmer side, because a lot of the times it came from like an academic side or maybe like producer or supplement producer side. Well, like a lot of the farmers, they're just shy. I mean, they have a lot of knowledge, but it's just like they're afraid to come out and then like talk, because again, it's just a different setting. But I keep encouraging all of my peers to like just, I mean, like the first time is always the hardest. Mm-hmm. Once you got that, and then the next time is gonna be easier, and then but it's a good way to be heard.
Yeah, yeah. I think you're setting a fantastic example.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
You're very you're obviously very knowledgeable in what you do, but you're also very nice to talk to, so that does help. Last question: how do you define sustainability in your work?
Okay. And in my business, I think a lot of people are keeps tying sustainability into the like environmental part. Well, actually, it's more than that. I mean, like a friend of I think there's a quote from my friend who told me that like you can talk whatever you want about sustainability, like environmental sustainability, but if you're not making a profit, you're not gonna go anywhere anyway. Because again, like with that profit, then you can start to make improvement to be better at the environmental sustainability or social sustainability. But again, like as a business, you have to, that's how you survive. You have to have, like that's the bare minimum. You have to be profitable to make a change. Again, like coming back to the profit part, sustainability also means that your company will stand the test of time. Hopefully you can pass that to your children or to the next generation. And that's, I think also it's one part of the sustainability that is neglected.
Okay.
So again, like you have to make a profit to make a change.
Yeah.
And it's something that's really important.
Okay. You can't have a positive impact if you're not there anymore.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Rizky, this has been tremendously insightful. Thanks very much for your time.
It's a pleasure.